holy calamity, scream insanity. Or are you ever going to be another great fan of me? Break.
What's up? Welcome to another episode of the Open Micers Podcast. I'm Micah Hanner.
I'm JD Etheridge.
Me and this bitch with Abdou. How's it going?
Good. How are you?
Yeah. How do you say your last name?
Derrar.
Derrar. Okay. Yeah. That's fucking lit. We talked about. I was like, do you know Abdou's ethnicity in the car? And I was like, no, but I think you're first of your kind. That's what
nobody does.
Yeah.
Nobody ever does. I'm Algerian.
Okay.
Yeah. Wait, say it again.
Algerian.
Algerian.
Yeah. It's North Africa. It's actually the biggest country in Africa. It's,
okay.
Right.
They gotta talk more. They gotta write more books.
Yeah, they don't really do much, but that's, I guess that's good. There's a lot of places that aren't at war with people, and we're not one of them.
Yeah,
so that's always good.
Have you visited there? Or were you born there?
Wasn't born there. I haven't visited in a while. It's probably been like 15 years at least.
Yeah.
It's been a long time. But my mom goes all the time. My sisters go all the time.
What's it like? What is it like there?
It's hard to describe. I mean, they've gotten, I wouldn't consider it anywhere like a third world country anymore.
Okay.
I mean, they've definitely progressed a lot next to, you know, I mean, they got Morocco and Egypt right next to them.
Sure.
So like they've got a lot of influences.
Yeah. Is there any comedy clubs, do you think?
I'm sure.
There's a comedy club?
Yeah, I'm sure there's comedy
clubs. Yeah,
there has to be.
Some Algerian open mics? Okay.
We should hit some.
I would hit an Algerian open mic.
That would be awesome.
If this episode sounds kind of crazy, it's because we're recording this in a comedy club. We're at Good Nights Comedy Club.
Yeah.
We're taking this bitch on the road, people. Look, we're mobile.
Doing big things.
Yeah, mm-hmm. It sounds like we're kind of ghosts, but it gives it a nice vibe. How old are you and how long have you been working for the club?
I'm 24. And
hey, we out here.
I've been working here for about 3 years, maybe a little over 3 years.
Yeah.
Yeah.
What made you even start working here?
Well, honestly, I was just kind of looking for a job. And you guys remember Sean?
Yeah.
Right? He was a good friend since high school.
Mm-hmm.
So he got me the job here, and I started just as like a regular door guy, like an usher.
Yeah.
And then slowly but surely just kind of work through different positions.
Yeah.
I don't know why I thought you were like 35 or some shit like
really?
That. Really? Just like, just because you got it.
I thought you were like 28.
Anybody in a managerial position, I'm like, oh yeah, they got that shit together.
Yeah, so you really, I feel like, I mean, you're like Audi lifestyle. Like, you're like.
Yeah, you're driving an Audi. We were like, oh shit, who is that?
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, it took a while.
What'd you go to college for? Like, what did you even do?
I didn't even start.
See,
never started college.
That's where we fucked up.
We fucked up early.
I don't have a need for. I mean, like I always have a backup plan. So even if I do leave here, I always have something lined up.
Sure.
You
got your shit together. I like this.
Yeah, I don't want to spend.
Yeah.
Why spend a waste of 4 years and maybe like 80 to 100 grand?
Do you see why he thinks you're 30 though? You got 30 like mentality.
Yeah.
You're like,
yeah,
you got the been there mentality. Yeah. Where does that come from? Is that Algerian shit?
I guess so. And I mean, I don't know. I grew up with two older brothers too. So I mean, none of us.
Are you the youngest?
Yes.
Okay.
Out of the three brothers, yeah.
How old are they?
One's 25 and the other one's 26.
Nice. That's just enough head where they can be like, don't go to college.
Yeah.
If I had a younger brother, I mean, I do have a younger brother, but he's not that close in age. Mm-hmm. I would be like,
if it's free, I say go. If you can get a scholarship.
If you can finesse it, go. Yeah, finesse the plug.
You can get a scholarship, an athletic scholarship, an academic.
Or if you're going to pay for it, go for something that's going to pay you back.
Yeah, but who knows in 4 years what can change, like what they'll still need and what they don't need. Like, it's just, I mean, you never know. So, like, you could go to college for something and spend 4 to 6 years on it, and then 6 years later, you
come. I don't know if I would straight up. Is this my water?
Yeah.
Okay.
Lunch down here.
I feel like I've drank out of mine. Maybe. Well, I'm having like water inception. Have you drank out of yours? Mm-hmm. All right, whatever. Fucking ghost water. Whatever.
There is a ghost in the building.
The number one thing I would say, maybe no college, but I'd be like, dog. I do this thing where I teach music or whatever. And so I had one of these high schools that I straight up told. I was like, bro, because I was teaching this kid, but it wasn't out of high school. It was like this independent music thing or whatever. And I was like, I'm going to be real honest with you, man. Just go to community college for 2 years, stay at your parents' crib, work at some restaurant, fucking waiting tables or whatever, fuck the girls that are like locally and didn't go anywhere and have nowhere going to like, don't get them pregnant. Do
your
that.
Your advice is kind of fucked up.
No, I'm telling my mom, like, do that, get your gen eds out of the way, make good grades, get a scholarship, and then go to college in Hawaii, dude. Go to college, go start being a freshman after having some life experience, some money in your pocket, trick them to paying for it, and just fucking, you know, I just remember a lot of the pressure to go to college was like, I'm going to meet people, I'm going to party. If you stay at home and don't go off to college, you'll still party. You'll be fine. Yeah. You're gonna have friends. You can have a life. It's not gonna instant. I mean, it's probably gonna feel like that for a little bit, but you're gonna get Audi life. You know what I mean? You're gonna be fine. Everything works out.
And then even Joey and Brandy. I mean, they started as a bartender and a server.
Yeah. So, you know. And coming out of college, I definitely go to places. I'm like, I'm worthless. I really don't have any job experience that's like worth a piece of shit to like any type of like regular job. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So Sean hooked you up for the job. You weren't like, I want to work at like. Were you excited about working here? Because like, this is a comedy
club. I was.
Yeah.
I was definitely excited, but I didn't at the time. I didn't even like it. It didn't faze me how awesome it would be until I actually started working here and watching those shows and seeing those comedians and meeting those open mic comics and all that stuff. So it was like, it
is such a community that like really operates right under the public sphere, especially the open mic level of it. You're like, oh, these people just live around here and they like are pursuing comedy. Yeah. The same thing I see professional. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
What is your experience like growing up watching comedy? Were you big into stand up? Were you
not much in stand up, but I was always like, I mean, comedy was always a thing for me, like between cartoon shows and you know, movies and all that stuff.
You had some favorites, cartoon shows?
Growing up, probably Ed, Edd n Eddy was my favorite.
It's gonna be whatever we watch because our age.
I don't know. Just the standouts. I was then gonna be like, you know, I fucked with, you know, Angry Beavers was my shit for.
I didn't get that show for the longest.
I just liked it when they ate the logs. I was like, this logs look delicious. I don't know about it. Same thing with the gumballs and Ed, Edd n Eddy. You ever had a gumball? It's okay. Yeah. It's kind of like a job. It's like a fucking 4 hour shift.
I got one because I watched the TV show.
Exactly. A little one's fine. You get one of those big ones, you're just like, wow, this is eroding my teeth.
Yeah.
In real time.
Yeah.
And I've licked one so hard, it like burnt my tongue.
We had to put them in plastic bags because we couldn't finish them.
And then you work on it. Exactly.
I don't like committing like to something as a kid.
Yeah, it's committing to a cavity.
You can't put the whole thing in your mouth. You gotta lick it like some kind of. It's very perverted when you think about it.
But when you see the different layers, you're like, what's the next color gonna be? The flavor never really changed. That was my thing. It was like sugary and chalky.
It was sugar ball the whole time.
Sugar ball.
Layers of different
But they
colors.
Would go, remember when they break into the bank and there's like, we got this jawbreaker and that jawbreaker and they're huge and they got little, and like,
they're like sparkling and the
fucking trailer park chicks are like trying to fuck them the entire time. Like, the whole thing was, I loved the foreign neighbor dude or whatever that always Rolf. Had to go, that dude, he was always doing the craziest shit.
Yeah, he had his own farm at like,
they're all 12 or something like that. Like,
and you know what's key about those shows and what they nail? When his kids hanging out in the neighborhood, they never really include the parents because the parents are never around. Like when you're really interacting, the stuff that picks out in your mind, you're never like, oh, we're all watching a movie with the you know what I mean? Or some bullshit. Yeah. It's
well,
like,
there's like a fan theory. You guys ever heard of those?
Yeah, I've heard of fan theory. Yeah.
So there's like a whole big.
It's just beginning. I don't know. It's like, real sad.
Yeah, but there's this thing where like it says that like they're all in purgatory or something like that. And that's why their parents aren't around and they're all like dead. Like, it's just.
Bullshit.
Yeah, Rugrats was like they're all dead, like feeling little with aborted fetuses.
Well, that it's Angelica is the one that's imagining all these people, and I'm like, her mom was working a lot.
I can't read this and still feel good about my childhood.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know. I really fucked with Rugrats. I'm gonna be honest. I was like, I want to be the cool baby like Tommy. Like, if I was a baby, I was imagining, like, when I was a baby, I was Tommy. You know what I mean? Like, I was having to go back. I was trying to remember, like, baby memories.
I wasn't doing much as a baby.
You're Chucky?
No, I was just like a regular baby, not talking. No adventures. Just waiting for shit to happen.
Not traveling to China and shit.
Didn't they have that one movie with the Thornberries or something like that?
That shit was lit. Yes. I fucked with the Thornberries.
I watched all that shit.
I fucked with that.
I watched the first Rugrats movie that made me cry a little bit.
Oh, the orange tape?
Well, Tommy got mad at Dill, and they were fighting in the woods, and it was raining, and I was like, this is too much. And I watched the fucking Paris joint.
That's when you actually start fucking with Angelica, because you see, like, oh, she's going through shit.
She's going through some things.
Yeah, and she's the oldest one around. She's supposed to know better, but she's hanging out with these babies.
Yeah, for real. She's torturing them.
Torturing these babies. She's fucked up.
God. Those shows are crazy, man.
So crazy. the fucking stillborn theory, because and then there's no wife around, and I don't know, it's crazy. But they, yeah. the fan theories never include the Asian chick in anything. They never, they're like, yeah, that was legit. That. Yeah, they just met an Asian lady. They did go to Paris. Oh man, what's another good ass show? I fuck with Cat Dog.
That, I was just gonna say that.
Cat Dog was good.
Like, so why weird. Did they put so much like, in, like on the surface it was dumb.
Yeah,
but we ate it up. Like the dude, dumbest awesome. Shit.
Dude, you relate to this. Adam Cohen, do you know, like, he does, he's done cartoons before or whatever?
Uh-huh.
Back in the day, I guess he was writing a cartoon. He was legit selling it, trying to sell it to, like, Cartoon Network. And it was, like, they did this thing where, like, him and, like, three other cartoons that he had made were, like, they made, like, games of them, or you could vote online, like, hey, which one everyone would play the game, whichever game you like. If you like it, vote for it. We'll actually make this into a show. And I think he came in second, and the first show that came in first was Kids Next Door.
Oh, what?
So he lost out. Yeah, I remember watching that show hard as hell.
That's
fair. I felt bad for it. I was like, dude, that sucks, because I loved that show. And that could have been you, and I could have never met you. You would have been off and whatever. He said his show was basically if all the cereal box characters, like the Lucky Charms dude, Count Chocolate, if they all had like a community and hung out. And all the different characters or whatever. And I was like,
I would watch that.
I would watch the fuck out of that.
And you know, that seems so smart from like a marketing perspective, because yeah, we got serious.
Kids Next Door, it didn't make sense though, storyline wise or something. Like, because like when you got to a certain age,
it's the Illuminati of children.
When you got to a certain age, they deactivated you, yeah, and you like was, you became the enemy.
You forgot everything. But that's, you fight back to.
I'm like, why is it perpetual violence?
Because they say that. I think that was a bigger message for you grow up and you're not a kid. And you're like, I'm trying to get pussy. I'm not trying to fucking play in the street house anymore. I'm trying to fuck number five. That's what's trying to go down.
All right, like, yeah, I guess. I don't know. It was a weird show.
I like the shows that were like, we're fighting it back against growing up. You know what I mean?
I didn't like those shows that much. I wanted to grow up. I wanted to do shit.
I like being a kid.
What about?
I had a neighborhood. I don't know. I feel like you're off on your own. Just with your brothers and shit. Yeah.
Nobody real cut butt outside, nigga. Yeah. Nobody trying to be outside.
What were you about to say?
What about Invader Zim?
Oh, bro, that was a shit. That was good.
I couldn't go too deep on that show. I'd be like, yo, what the fuck
is going on? It was hilarious.
You know what fucked me up about
the
show?
It was dark, but it was funny.
You know what fucked me up about the show? I was like, this is on Nick. This should be on Cartoon Network. If this is on Cartoon Network, I would watch it. But I'm trying to be on Nickelodeon.
But see,
right
there was a point in time when you could like keep up with all the channels. Like Disney, Cartoon Network, and Nickelodeon were all Disney was always number three. You're right.
But yeah. It would be trash, but when everything else was trash, Disney would have the heat. I'd be like, I want to see what Hillary Duff is doing.
Disney would have like hot live action movies.
I swear to God, I just kind of remember this. When I watched Hillary Duff, in a little bit in my mind, I was thinking, I was like, this is how I'll spy on white girls. This is how I'll learn what white girls like. And this is how I'll then hang out with
them.
She's
like the most basic fake white girl in the history.
A lot of girls watched it. It helped.
Disney was always trash, but Nickelodeon at one point was trying to keep up Cartoon Network. And it would like get edgier and edgier shows to show like at nighttime. Yeah. But then eventually Cartoon Network was like, fuck you, Adult Swim. Yeah. And Nickelodeon was like, we can't keep up, so go ahead and take the title.
Adult and Nick Swim at Night is, now is just like Nick throwbacks, honestly.
Yeah, straight up.
Like Bill Cosby, don't tell anybody.
Yeah. They treat Martin now like they treated a fucking all
Did they be
family
playing
and shit
Martin
like
that?
It was on a marathon yesterday, 25-year anniversary.
Oh, that's lit.
It was 25 years ago. That was when I was born, that's when that shit came out.
Martin was lit.
Yeah.
Martin was fucking lit. Martin was like, you know, if we're going to talk about it, it was like fucking, what's his name? Black Seinfeld in my mind.
Kind of like Black Seinfeld. It was like black everything at a certain point.
Yeah, it was black everything, yeah.
I mean, saying for all the sitcoms and shit.
I'm
like,
talking about
everything.
Like, it was just like at the top, I feel like it was booming at the same time. And I just feel like he was black people's Seinfeld. Like, how many black people watch Seinfeld?
I'm saying, you had Seinfeld, you had Frasier, you had Cheer, you had all that shit, you know what I'm saying, going on. Like, black sitcoms weren't like that. You ain't have a lot like that. You had fucking Family Matters. You had fucking The Jeffersons.
The Jeffersons, yeah.
I mean, what, you got the Good Times. I mean, like, say some other shit other than those three. Like, and, like,
I'm thinking about the ones that come after.
Like Fall Off, more like the Hughleys.
Not fucking the Hughleys. I was like, give me another version of this. I was about to say, I fuck with the Damon Wayans. His, I loved his. Because didn't he have the wife of somebody else's in another one? I don't know.
It was
nice.
Mari.
It was. I was like, Gina, go ahead, girl, do it. I fucking love Gina.
But yeah, there weren't many at the time, so that was like the main one.
Yeah. I like Black Seinfeld, to be honest. I'm going to stick with that comparison.
Hey, go for it if you want to.
Hey, I feel like, and culturally, I mean, How many black people do you think watch Seinfeld? Did you watch Seinfeld when it was
I never watched Seinfeld.
You've never watched it?
I see clips and shit and like people like, this show is funny and smart, and I'm like, I just don't want to trudge through. I don't want to trudge through episode one type shit.
I'm gonna be honest.
To get through,
there is no trudging. It straight up is just funny. That's why it's so good and why it's so like honestly you can feel that way about it, because if you watch it, you're like, this is funny. And this is it.
But
is
like I said, when I see the clips, I laugh. But I'm like, I'm not sitting down watching an episode.
But you don't have to. You could watch any. That's the thing. You can watch any episode at Netflix. Any point. I don't know, but you can. Fucking, it's on YouTube, bro.
It's
on
Netflix. I ain't trying
to. Maybe it's on Netflix. I feel like Jerry.
It probably
like,
is. I mean,
see, I fuck with Cheers though. But I was watching TV.
I loved. I love sitcoms. I really did, because I would catch them on Nick at Night whenever they would replay. Because Cheers didn't drop whenever we had Cheers. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like I watched Roseanne, and it was because it was like Nick at Night. But Roseanne wasn't dropping when we were growing up. Right?
I just watched it with my grandma watched, honestly. Seriously.
Really?
Whatever she was watching. I mean,
how much Golden Girls you end up watching?
A shit ton of Golden Girls. That show was good. I don't give a fuck with nobody.
It was like vanilla Sex and the City. They took Sex and the City and like, what if they weren't battled?
It was
battled?
Better than
what if
Sex and the City
because old?
These are old women. They ain't got time for that bullshit. They fucking, they got
but they fucking though. They be fucking.
One was fucking.
That Sex and the City was
two,
like,
okay, really two were fucking, but one was fucking, but the other one fucked. Everybody's like, you go, girl. It was like that.
Yeah. Sex and City, they were like, what if they were a little less old and everybody fucking?
I was like, I don't dig this. There's no sassy mom in the house.
I didn't like the narration of Sex and the City. I don't like how it was the main bitch always being like, well, this is what I thought about that. And it's like, just write the show. Let it play. Let me think about what I thought about that. Well, I don't give a fuck what you thought about that. That was my whole thing.
How so was TV shows?
Fucking Frank. I don't know.
Is that Abdou's fault?
I don't remember.
We talked about Cat Dog for a little bit, which I still don't understand.
Ed and Eddie. That's what started it.
Do you remember the first time you... Was he working at Good Night's the first time you ever saw stand-up live?
Yes.
Was it an open mic or was it a... Well, do you remember what it was?
No, honestly. I can't even remember. It's been a long time.
That long, yeah.
Yeah. I mean, seeing a different comedian every single weekend, it's hard for me to remember who was here last month.
Yeah. A question I was definitely going to ask you, what have been, like, the craziest shows you've seen?
Top five craziest.
Yeah.
Craziest?
Or, like, hardest you've
seen
somebody
in the crowd started crying, somebody started fighting.
We did have a fight.
Yeah.
I don't remember. It was, like, just two ladies arguing over table space and then ended up jumping, like actually jump fighting and stopping the show.
That's
and
awesome.
We had to like kick them out in the middle of a show and pick tables back up and all that stuff.
Nice.
So that was crazy.
Okay.
Michael Blackson.
Yeah.
Okay, what happened?
That was nuts. He'd like takes his shirt off and then he like pops out his belly and he does like the starving African child thing. And
very familiar.
He pulls a lady's purse from the table and just starts going through it. Like, just the most, he's just the craziest person ever.
That is lit.
That's crazy. It's working. You're getting paid for it. Like,
you're like, hey, I'm the starving African baby and I'm gonna take your purse and go through it. In front of everybody, you know what's gonna happen.
Steve-O took his pants off on stage. Like,
And that was enough for you. You were like, oh,
sack
shit.
In between his legs.
Oh, yeah,
that was weird.
How many other stunts did he do, like, in a set? Like, I've heard that he does do jokes, too, but he also does, like, a solid amount of stunts.
Yeah, he does. I didn't see a whole show because, I mean, that was a crazy weekend. So we had stuff going on all floors, so I was jumping around. But I think the craziest thing I saw him do was take a cup of water that was on his head and grab it with his feet and then drink it.
What do you mean? Like, it was on his head?
Like, it was on his head. And he took his feet and grabbed the cup of water and then drank it with his feet.
Wow.
That's impressive.
That is impressive as fuck.
He is...
Was it like a plastic cup? Was it a mug?
It was a plastic cup, I'm pretty sure.
It was a plastic cup. Flimsy-ass plastic cup. That's incredible.
That's dexterity.
Yeah, shout out to Steve-O. That's fucking lit. Why am I writing jokes? I need to stretch.
For real.
To stretch.
But probably my favorite was Craig Robinson, just because I was a huge fan of The Office.
Yeah.
Nice.
So when he came, he played all like the theme song for The Office and like songs that they did.
Nice.
Like, he was great on the piano.
Yeah. He's fucking killer at the piano.
Yeah. So that was definitely by far my favorite too.
Yeah. So as you're getting this job and you're working the door, I'm so curious. Like, when do you start realizing there's like local comedians that also do this? Like, what is that like? You're like, oh, these like, I'm just like, I'm trying to understand like the perception of working at a comedy club from being a regular person. Does that make sense?
What do you,
like when you started working here, you're like, okay, so these dudes are just regular people that mm-hmm. want to do comedy. They come here for these open mics and they eventually want to get on stage. Like, what? I don't know. I guess I don't know what question I'm asking.
You confused yourself.
Yeah, I did confuse myself with the question, but it made sense in my mind when I first was asking.
Do you have a general idea?
I think he's probably saying, like, how do you, like, going from just seeing, because I mean.
Or like, were you telling people, like, I work at a comedy club, and they're like, I don't care. And they're like, but there's people, the shit is happening. Because it's weird, because it's not like working a restaurant job.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
No, it's nothing like that. Yeah,
so it's like, you don't think about people doing comedy until you see it. You know what I'm saying? Oh, yeah. Like, you don't, like, I didn't think nothing about a comedy scene in North Carolina, let alone know they had one.
Yeah.
Until I went to open mic and, like, started meeting people. So, like,
yeah.
That transition from, like,
oh, you're
not
a mom,
knowing about comedy to, like, oh, this dude's a piece of shit, gonna be here forever. Trying to bug. Like I'm saying, you're seeing dudes that are making it, and then you're seeing dudes that are gonna bug you for the next 7 years. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, but I mean, for the most part, people who do open mics are pretty, I mean, they're not usually assholes. I mean,
true.
One in a bunch, but.
Yeah.
They're usually like pretty understanding, they got a good head on their shoulders, and they know when, I mean, being on stage, you know the crowd's reaction. So if you're talking to a single person, you should know their reaction.
Yeah.
Like if they're like, don't talk to me. Obviously, they get the 2 cents. I mean,
I guess my main question was just, it's so cool to, you're just working a job. And then in this job, you're understanding what it means to be a comedian. That's a part of the, like, you really are getting, you're like, you put in the time, you work on the jokes, you have stage presence, you need to work. Like, you could, I mean, even just from being around it, you could take someone that's been doing it for a day and been like, well, you might want to move the mic stand out of the way. Or, you know what I mean? You could you know, it's just a cool thing, a part of a job. It's different than working at Applebee's. You know what I mean?
Yeah, no, definitely. Seeing people progress is awesome always. And, like, seeing them make the smallest little tweaks to a little joke that, you know, changes a lot is, like, is great. And then, you know, obviously seeing people go up for the first time is always just
a spectacle.
Yeah, always.
Yeah, constantly. Yeah. Working here, have you ever thought, like, I'm gonna fucking get on the stage, I'm about to show these motherfuckers how
I actually
get this
have
shit.
Once.
Really?
I did Charlie's class.
Yeah,
well,
yeah.
No, it wasn't his class, but
sure.
You know, when he was teaching. And we did a graduation show, like we always do. And I did 3 minutes. I don't remember much of it, but
I was about to say, I didn't even know this dude. What, do you remember any of these jokes?
Oh, shit.
Yeah. God, oh, shit. He's an Abdou. Yeah, you ever be driving in your fucking Abdou?
I have.
You just like vroom on these bitches. The crowd's like going,
you have low body fat.
Yeah, you ever keep lifting? Constantly.
You ever save money by not going to college?
Yeah.
You didn't drive a fucking Audi yet?
You ever finesse the system completely from your peers? you ever have a country of origin just come up over time with you not even being there? Sorry. But do you remember any of these jokes?
Not really, but I have a video of it on Facebook. I'm pretty sure.
So this exists.
But yeah, it was a while ago, I think 2 or 3 years, and the crazy part was the owner's little brother was here watching me.
Nice.
So that was kind of awkward knowing that he was here. And like, I was
like, aren't you supposed to be telling people where to go?
Yeah. And I mean, my jokes were, I remember it not being the cleanest
stuff.
So it was like weird just having him there listening to me say all
for
this
sure.
stuff and then becoming a manager like within a month later.
So it wasn't that quick. So what was like your progression work? How long were you an door guy? And then like how'd that work?
So I got hired as an usher. I spent 2 or 3 months as an usher / like food runner.
Mm-hmm.
And then I did security for about 3 months.
Oh,
and then
security.
I did, I washed dishes for 3 months.
Yeah.
I cooked for 6 or 7 months. And then I was assistant.
And are you just willing to do anything? Like every time they're asking. So why are, I don't know, are you, I mean, I assume you're good at your job. You're like moving around. So are you like, when you go from usher to security guard, you're like, this is the path.
Yeah. Well,
eventually
I'm
going to wash dishes.
Exactly. I mean, if you stick around long enough, you learn those different positions. When you see an opening, you jump on it.
For sure.
So, and then when you have enough experience in each one of those positions and a manager knows that you do, that's how you can progress. Be like, hey, I'm here all the time. I can work any position you want me to. How about making me assistant manager, which I was for a while. And, you know, and then when our old chef left, I took advantage of taking over the kitchen.
Yeah.
Now I'm like doing obviously both. Sometimes I'm front of house. Sometimes I'm in the kitchen. Sometimes, you know.
Yeah. So, I mean, I'm getting from the, I'm just curious, like, what's family life like? Where did you get this work ethic from?
I don't know. I mean, I've always been pretty much a hard worker. Yeah. I mean, like, since I started working when I was like 14.
Did you grow up here in North Carolina, mainly?
No, I was born in Brooklyn,
New York. Okay, word.
Yeah.
How long were you there? When did you move?
14 years.
Yeah.
So I moved right after eighth grade. It was the worst move ever.
Yeah. Because you're like, this is all I got, dog.
Oh, no. I didn't know I was moving.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Oh,
dang. Yeah, my parents tricked us into moving here.
Wow.
Yeah, so that was interesting. We had cousins here, and they were like, hey, let's go visit our cousins right after eighth grade. So we're coming down here for the summer. We were here for about a week or two, and they were like, oh, shit, we got to take care of something back in New York. So they went back to New York and just came back with, like, a truck.
That was their plan the whole time.
They left you here and went back.
Yeah, they left us
in
here
Raleigh. You came straight to Raleigh.
Yeah.
What did you think? That, like when did you start cracking the pieces? How long did you believe the lie?
Well, when they got back with a truck full of everything, I was kind of like, oh, girl, this is happening.
I guess
they'd
be like, oh, what happened?
They
don't
know the week. Yeah. Like, so when they came back, they're like, oh, I guess we're staying here now.
Yeah.
Pissed were you? Were you like?
I was pretty pissed for a while.
And was all three brothers like, we're tearing down the house?
It was bad. Like, I left eighth grade, so I started freshman year here not knowing, like, I knew maybe two people in the entire high school.
What high school did you go to?
Broughton.
Okay.
Right down the block. So that was tough, but it was a lot, like, it's a lot calmer here. So, like, after growing up, I understand why they...
Yeah, why they were leaving, because they're like, these dudes are fucking...
I mean, it was crazy. Craziness. I mean, growing up, I mean, in, I think it was third or fourth grade, I was telling someone about this last night, I saw the 9/11 happen.
Yeah, I was about to say, I was in third grade.
Yeah.
God damn, so you were there, dude.
I saw it, my teacher's husband was in the class, in the building.
It was
a huge thing. Like,
I remember 9/11. Yeah. I literally never forget. That's the whole thing.
Walking home from school, like, not being able to look down at your feet, like, you couldn't see. It was just ash everywhere. You had to wear, like, hazmat.
Dude,
like,
dude, that is so crazy. Because you were in class. I was in class.
Yeah.
Can you give me a layout? Can you give me, like, do you remember that day specifically?
Yeah, I mean, like, our building was a pretty big building. It was, like, I don't, you said you were... there, right? Well,
I was. I just remember. I remember it happening where I was specifically.
Okay. Where were you?
I grew up in North Carolina. I grew up in Wisconsin.
Oh, okay. Yeah. So, it was like a pretty big building. So we were on like the fourth or fifth floor, and you can see pretty much everything, like the whole like skyline.
So middle schools are in big buildings. Okay.
Well, I was in elementary school at the time.
Oh yeah.
So it was like a huge. It was a huge elementary school. And we're on like the fourth floor, and I just remember like. You literally, it's like plain sight. You can see everything, and then you just see the first.
Do you feel like you saw the first plane?
I definitely saw. Well, I didn't see it actually hit, but
immediately you see. Yeah you hear because, it. Like, what did it sound like?
It was pretty loud, and like I mean, we're all. I'm sitting like I am now, and it's like on my left, and there's nothing but windows. So if you look out, like even if you see something off the corner of your eye, like the little bit of light, you immediately turn.
Yeah.
And the teacher just like froze immediately and was staring out the window. So all the kids turned and looked. So they immediately like took all the kids, brought them into the auditorium. And we had to stay there until our parents individually came to pick us up.
Yeah.
And we were on lockdown first for like 4 hours because they... You know, it was like a terror thing.
So yeah.
Locked down all the schools.
But, I mean, it's going down. I mean, are kids, like, running to the auditorium? Or are they just, like, all, like, what did we just see?
The teachers immediately closed the windows. So, like, you didn't see the second.
You didn't see the second wind. But did you hear it? You had to.
Not from the auditorium.
Okay, no. Wow.
Because they were, like, it's like a, dude, that building was huge. And, like, their auditorium fit, like, probably, like, 2,000 students, if not more.
And what is, I mean, yeah, were people run, like, what is the vibe? Like, what is...
The teachers were trying to keep everyone calm, but everyone knew pretty much what was going on.
Like, the kids were like, we know what's going down.
Yeah, I mean, after you see the first one, and then, like, kids obviously talk, so, like...
Yeah.
You know, one word was going from another, and, like, everyone knew, especially if you're all in one room.
One room, for real. Like, I saw it happen.
It's, like, early in the morning, you hadn't even went to lunch yet.
No. We're in school for maybe 2 hours. I think it happened right around 9 o'clock.
It's like 9 o'clock in the morning. Yeah, yeah, so I was still in like my first like class of doing things.
Yeah.
Dude, they just, I remember for me, I'm literally in class. A teacher comes in, it's kind of like upset, but not really very visibly.
Mm-hmm.
She tells the teacher something. They go outside, they talk for like 10, she says nothing to us. She says, they walk out. And we don't really say anything, we kind of like talk. 10 minutes later, they roll in the TV, and they cut the TV on and just show us everything that's happened.
That's
and we,
not what they did in my school.
And we watched the second plane hit live. That's how quickly that like we got, like we heard about it. They were like, this just happened.
Yeah.
I guess their thought process is like, we need to inform everyone. Because then they were like, this just happened. We are about to call your family. Like you're about to like, I think we were about to meet in the auditorium. We're watching it, mm-hmm. Boom, we see the second plane hit.
Niggas just start getting pulled out of class.
What?
Like people's parents are like, it saw it, they went to school and like, said, I'm getting my son, I'm getting my daughter. Like,
yeah.
Everybody started going home one by one.
What, I mean, you go home, what are your parents saying? What are you, I guess you're...
At that point, we got home and like, we were just, I mean, like everyone else, we were watching TV, but like, it was just fog everywhere. I remember the next day, there's like little burnt pieces of paper everywhere, like documents and like just everything, just all over the place. Is
damn
filthy,
dude.
For like at least a good week or two, like just shit everywhere.
So I mean, obviously you have a real personal investment in what happened at 9/11. Obviously we all do because we're Americans, but obviously it was way more real because it was like really in your community.
Yeah.
You were literally there. I mean, growing up, I mean, do you entertain the ideas? Like, have you ever, like, I've gone down the rabbit holes of conspiracy theories of who did it, blah, blah, blah.
Mm-hmm.
But is it something that, like, you don't even care to know about? Or is it, like, well, I was just curious.
Well, I mean, I feel like at this point, like, even if we did find out what really happened,
yeah,
if something really happened, then what's there to be done?
Yeah, it happened.
Yeah.
Like,
yeah.
16 years later.
Because I don't know if that would set me, like, because literally after we, like, watch it, I'm like a third grader. So the teacher is, like, trying to make this into an exercise. Before before they announce that our parents are coming to get us,
mm-hmm.
She's like, all right, literally, let's pull out paper and write about how this makes you feel. And, like, I remember I'm just going into this thing where my plan is to go home and, like, turn Super Saiyan 3. And then I'm going to go and fight evil. Like, I'm writing this whole thing about how this is the fuel. This is my Goku moment. This is the fuel I needed to save all America, to bring our energy together, to defeat our enemies. And I remember I was really serious about that. Like, I was like, I got to fight back. I got to fight back, guys. Like, I need to just harness my energy and just fucking be blonde. But I can't even, but I think, so I'm so charged up by this, like, literally then. So I feel like if I was there, like, I would be like, I'm going to find out what happened to Building 7, okay? Like, I'm going to figure out what the fuck happened. What is it in these beams? Like, I feel like, I don't know. That's nuts, man.
Yeah.
That's really nuts. Yeah. So, I mean, were your parents talking about moving immediately? Were you like, let's get the fuck out of here?
We definitely didn't move immediately. I mean, between, like, all the family we had and, like,
mm-hmm.
you know, they couldn't make any immediate changes.
Sure.
But they were definitely thinking about it right after. I mean, it was not a place to raise kids.
Yeah. What was the energy of New York?
It was dirty. It was always busy. You couldn't get around anywhere.
Yeah.
Homeless people, rats. It's just like,
it's crazy.
So you were happy we came down here?
Well, I mean,
it had been a minute.
I had my friends, you know.
Yeah.
But like,
yeah,
seeing the change of environment, I was like, okay, this is a little bit better. Like, in my middle school in New York, it was like so bad that we had 3 cops on each floor at all times. We had
on each floor,
on
and
each
this is just
floor.
Just literally because post 9/11, you feel like it was the change of that, and then there
was
like,
because that was,
you remember New York before 9/11.
Yeah, because that was 9/11 was like we said, third grade, and
mm-hmm.
then middle school was, you know, 3 years later.
Yeah, and you're like, fuck, man, we're still. That's so crazy. I mean, you have to have some type of kinship, even growing up with those people. Not only because I grew up with them, but like, dude, we literally went through 9/11 together. We were here. We have this bond. This, like, I mean, the thing is, never forget. But there's like some shit that like really, you know, wow. I mean,
but being there, that's one of those things that you kind of want. Like, you put it that on the like the back of your head. Like, you don't want to, like, you know, you never want to relive that moment. Obviously, no one wants
to
be through that again.
Yeah.
You know? So I mean, that's something that like. It's always just like, I mean, I always think about it every now and again, but
sure.
It's never like something I want to think about.
That's crazy. So when did you start coming around to being in North Carolina? At one point were you like, all right, this is pretty chill. What up?
I'd say probably like within a even a year.
Yeah.
You know, just seeing, like, you know, once I started getting to know people, once I, you know, started enjoying my school, my classes.
Yeah.
It became a lot easier.
Yeah. What were you like in school? What was your vibe? What lane did you find? Because you had to carve a whole new lane day one of freshman year. That's hard to do.
But yeah, I was always, I mean, even middle school, elementary school, I was always a troublemaker. I mean,
hell yeah.
I almost got expelled in like second grade.
Doing what?
We had a science project, and my science project was making a fire with a 9-volt battery and a Brillo pad.
Nice.
So it was okay in class to do, since it was science class, but it wasn't okay to show people during lunch.
Yeah. Hey, look, we can get it popping right here. I know how to do it.
We started a little fire.
You should have been like, I want to be a scientist. And this is my story. This is how I do this shit. That's amazing.
Yeah. High school, skipped a lot of classes. So that
skipping's nice.
It was nice.
That's the thing they don't mention. Like, I did skipping.
One time, I was like, no, do it again.
What? Why?
Get caught, nigga. Dude, what's the school going to call your house?
Oh, you give them the wrong number. You give them your number.
Yeah.
school had our number. Like, it was like since day one. Like, through grade school, they had that whole number, like, the whole time.
No one's moving.
We ain't going nowhere.
Same like, spot.
Keep calling the house and shit.
I just filled out my own paperwork when
you
I
did?
Was, yeah.
Oh, yeah. Do this shit. Did you feel any type of mysterious brown hate after 9/11? Like, from your community, any of your peers, where they're like, hold on, where the fuck's Algeria? Like, yeah, where the fuck is that close?
No, not really, because, I mean, most of the time people look at me and don't even know what
that
I am.
You know, a lot of people know you. Like,
yeah,
I'm
and yeah, the people that
Brooklyn.
Knew exactly.
Yeah.
I've never been, like, racially, you know,
profiled,
ever.
Yeah.
Yeah.
When you came to the South, what were you thinking? Like, I'm about to be down here with a bunch of these idiots. Like, did you have any idea of,
I
like...
I no idea.
You're
of
like,
anything.
Like, what was the biggest sort of thing? Like, sweet tea, what the fuck? Why is everything fried? Like, what was your, like...
First, I was like, holy shit, there's a lot of trees. Because
yeah.
in New York...
Yeah, yeah, dude,
it's
yeah.
like nothing.
Yeah. holy shit. That's funny.
I was pretty happy. I mean, it's like, the air is cleaner.
Yeah.
Like, you know, the
something
the vibe.
Hey.
The vibe.
We got Mello in the building. This is actually perfect. We're about to pause because we actually need to change our batteries because he's about to run out. And then we're going to come back with Mello in the building. This is perfect. We'll be right back. Awesome. All right, boom. Welcome back. Same episode of the Open Micers. Nothing really happened for you, but we smoke cigarettes and Mello's here. So yeah. We're living in a whole new world. What's up, Mello?
What's going on, man? How you doing?
I'm doing good, man. I'm chilling, bro.
That's good. That's
yeah.
good.
Yeah, I hate, you're just showing us your car outside. Someone fucking stomped your shit in.
Yeah, yeah. I don't know, one of them chicks.
Trump's American. I'm on racism right now.
Nah. Well, I don't know. She might have been white.
Yeah. That's hilarious. God damn. I fucking came in my car once and someone dented the shit out of my old car, not the car I have now. And it's just such a weird feeling when something happened to your car when you weren't around. You're like, hold on, what? Who the fuck was here? One time, I guess I left my car unlocked or something. I left it like while I was like gone on like Christmas break doing something. I came back and the door was kind of open and someone had went through it. But I didn't have shit in my car. But it was very violating. I was like sitting in my driver's seat. I was like, somebody was here.
Yeah. Well, you saw it. Like, someone broke a piece off my car and was nice enough to put it in my car because I left my car unlocked.
I thought your window was down or something.
Nah, my car was... I ain't got nothing in my car.
Yeah.
If they want my information, they can have it. You can have my identity. Yeah. You can have my debt.
I thought maybe they were like, we'll put something in here. We'll fucking rearrange the shit. Now he's got shit in his car.
And how I get in as a new system. Like, damn, the MTV come through and
pimp
my ride.
Yeah.
It broke the outside.
That would have been sick about Pimp My Ride if they fucking made
it about you knowing.
Yeah, they made pretend like your shit got towed and you're like, fuck, you're like at a towing agency. You're like, can I get it? You're like, nah, you get it back. And they're like, why is there a gumball machine in my car? Why the fuck? I mean,
that'd
yeah, I like gum. I do like gum. You put a goddamn working gumball. That was literally one of the things.
What? That was a weird show.
That should be like, yo, you love your mom? Well, here's her face everywhere. Here's her number. There's a phone in the car, but it only calls your mother.
Yo, Jake like computers. We put a computer in every seat. I'm like, man, he can't use that.
He's
can't
driving.
Use
it. An exhibit is always there knowing no car information. Be like, yeah, rooms, bigger. Yeah.
Mello likes mermaids, so what we did was
yeah.
put fish in his car.
Like,
just just because they got bikini tops on.
Swear to God, they put a fucking hot tub.
They did. I saw that one. Yeah, that was awesome. Like what?
I like the one.
Your car clean.
It was so fake.
Exhibit would come out and be like, all right, guys, what's going on? They'd be like, all right, Exhibit.
Yeah. What's the real deal? Yeah, I really like that.
They're like, oh, I'm not doing anything for the next, like, 17 hours. Yeah, let's hang out. Like,
all right, yeah, he likes to paint, so we put a full art set in his trunk so we can do pottery on the go. And I'm like, all
right,
man, this is
You
weird.
Like crayons, right?
Yeah, for real.
They would ball out if they found out that you've ever said the word video games. They're like, here's an Xbox.
Straight up.
Like, they would always hook you up, and it's a projector. If you open the back,
that would be awesome. I would,
yeah,
I would
that was the go to.
They have some dope ones.
Was there any reaction when people were like, what the fuck?
I didn't want this.
Everybody's just like, wow, thank you, Exhibit.
There's some solid shows at the time. Remember that there was like a bus of like candidates and next. They would like, next. And they would drive. It was like originally Twitter.
Yeah.
It was like Twitter and
it's
a show.
That, it's like that special Joe. What's that nigga's Joe Mende?
Just
whatever.
Next. Like, I remember like some dude just stepped off the bus. Next. Like, good.
Yeah. I remember it was like the lesbian episode of that. That was back when it was edgy or something like that.
Yeah, right. Well,
this girl came all the way into the restaurant, sat down. Girl's like, next. And I was like, this is a disrespectful show.
Yeah. Krebs was crazy because it was like, yeah, my life is pretty much as baller, if not more baller than you thought. So,
but they rent those houses, man. Like, fuck it.
Really?
Why does that matter?
Bro, say it's just bullshit. It's bullshit. It's just like Exhibit comes out for like 3 hours, and probably like 30 minutes says, hey, this little script thing, and then leaves.
You think they rent it for the show?
Those houses and shit, nobody's living like that. I don't think niggas are living like that.
Hey, what about
Red Man? Some people are, but the pro skater niggas aren't living like that. The fucking...
Some of the pro skaters would have, like, regular-ass houses with, like, a skate park in the back. And it was just like, yeah.
The only one I believe was, like, fucking Soulja Boy shit. He was, like, fucking showing his apartment. He had, like, three PS4s, no, three PS3s, and broke two of them bitches because he's fucking... reckless.
What about the Red Man with his broken ass door and he had to put the wires together to ring the doorbell?
See, I fuck with those.
See, I know, right?
The Yin Yang Twins, I fuck with those. I'm like, you really just, you doing what you can right now. You doing what you can right now.
You right.
That Mariah Carey penthouse was real. I don't give a fuck what you said.
That's Mariah Money.
I ain't said that.
That's Mariah Money. She, at the end, she gets in the tub with like a towel and she's like, you guys have to leave. And she has a towel and she just gets in the tub and then throws the towel away. Like suds and shit. And I'm just like, you a hoe.
Man. I know, right?
I asked you to do this. This is a cameraman that showed up from Chris. This is your idea. Yeah, there's no production team for this. What are you doing?
I would be like, cut and retake. Yeah. Can you get out and get that towel?
Yeah,
I wouldn't even handle
this
towel.
This towel's wet. Just go. I don't know where your towels are. Get your towel.
Don't have me walking through your house.
Hell yeah.
I gain weight every time she see me. Yeah. What you got in your shirt, girl? Nothing. What's that clinging?
You know, we are kind of lucky. There's only like really one thing that happens when we're like turned on. It's just that it's not also that like our hand shrink or something. Yeah. You know what I mean? It's just like one thing, or like we lose our vision or some shit.
That,
like,
oh, know? That would be terrible. Because I would get in so many car wrecks.
Yeah. You're in class and she was like, come to the board. I'm like, I can't see anybody. And I'm so sorry.
You just smack face.
Yeah.
Damn, I wouldn't even be able to touch my dick no more.
Yeah. Well.
I would
do it still.
No, I'm saying like
I would do it.
I would like sometimes
I just watch
like,
porn
just because you don't want to.
Yeah, I don't want to go blind like shit.
Yeah.
Would be wrong time to go get glasses.
Maybe you can see,
but
it's blurry as fuck.
How long is it blurry?
For like 20 minutes after you come.
Okay.
It's like slowly.
It's like a flashbang or some shit.
You mean how lucky are we that like that's just it just affects us in one way, but it also produces all of life.
You know what? I'm pretty sure evolution might have came through and was like, all right, we got to change this game up, man.
Yeah,
I can't make fire when I can't see that.
Yeah, and they probably realized we're going to be fucking, so if we debilitate them too much, they'll never do anything.
Yeah. We won't have any more children, I'll tell you that.
Yeah, like, the biggest thing that happens after we come, we're like, I don't want to hang out anymore. Yeah. I want to fucking leave. Actually, you leave.
It'll be a lot. You see a lot of tops of heads.
Still,
go run errands.
You'll see a lot of tops of heads as dudes just looking straight down. Like,
fuck nah.
I gotta get to work today. I miss work 2 months straight.
Yeah.
I'm looking down. I'm gonna take the subway. With all the ugly people.
Yeah. I remember I tried to talk JD into what he would put up with for getting high. I was like, what if every time you got high, your back itched? And he was like, I'd be smoking weed with an itchy back. Well, but I kept saying stuff, but I don't know.
You see him up against a tree like, like a bear.
It ain't that bad.
Yeah, it feels good.
You get a back scratcher, you're fine.
Yeah.
What if every time you were high, while you're high, blonde? And you only got your vision back when you were sober.
Why would I do that? If I was saying, like, why would I cut off a sense? Why would I cut off a sense to get high? Because the point of getting high, the point of getting high is to, like, do shit that I normally would do, but just high and enjoy it. I can't watch movies with blurry vision and shit like that.
All right. What about, I think I've done this before. Would you quit smoking weed if every time you smoked weed, you couldn't get on the internet?
Say that again.
No.
Like every time you smoke weed, you couldn't get on Still Wi-Fi.
Is it a craziest like?
Wow. I would download the movie and then watch it offline.
Don't work. No electronics. We're cutting off.
No electronics.
Yeah.
Fine. I'll be outside.
Every time you smoke weed, you'll live like you're Amish.
Oof. Nah. Fuck that. I'll probably still get high.
Like, yeah, that's what I'm saying. You're like, I would get high.
I mean, I'd be like,
let's make some porridge. Like
I said no electronics, but yeah, if you live Amish.
What kind of weed is this? How strong is this weed? It's crazy cutting strong. Off. It's
an EMP. They call it EMP. That's what it is.
So when I light it up, all my electronics are fucking.
Ooh, for the next 2.5 hours.
How strong is the weed, though?
That's really strong.
That's how strong it is.
I would do a lot of walks in the woods.
Yeah, yep. You'd be exploring and shit.
I wouldn't smoke that weed. I wouldn't smoke. I'm like, this is too strong.
Is that just seeds and stems?
This weed's too strong. It has electromagnetic waves in it. And it's fucking up my house.
Yeah, they are.
As soon as you'd be like, who didn't pay the goddamn bill?
I'm fucking up my complex. I live in a complex. I'm fucking up my
weed
whole.
Weed does a lot. If they could just make weed do one more thing for us, I swear
like,
to God.
What do you need? If you need crack cocaine. You need the next step.
I don't know. If you could smoke weed, and that would be like walking your dog. Like you smoke weed and your dog gets walked. You know what I mean? It needs one more facility for
you
us
need
to be
an
like,
assistant.
Legalize the shit. You know what I mean?
Like if we had one more perk.
One more ability, yeah.
One more perk.
Because right now we're it cures cancer.
It does everything we need. Right now everybody's worried that it'll make you be a criminal or whatever, but like that's anxiety. If you smoke weed,
we are criminals. We're anxiety. Really smoking drugs.
Yeah, but
nobody's like smoking weed and like really going out committing. They might think about a crime. They're not doing that shit. Yeah. Like you're relaxing.
And you eating.
And even if they do that, they just an evil son bitch anyway.
You're gonna get caught. If you commit a crime while you're high, you're gonna get caught. You're moving slow, you're not thinking straight.
And if a dude that crazy, he probably need weed not to
be crazy.
What? Yeah. Straight up. you're right.
Here we go. What was it like the first time you smoked weed?
Passed out.
What was it like? Where'd you get it from? What was?
I was like 12.
I was in sixth grade.
I had two older brothers, so yeah. I mean, you know, it's hard to not say no. True. You know, and so
good peer pressure. That's a real thing we don't talk about, like past like the fourth grade.
I feel it all the time.
Oh no, yeah.
I want to smoke cigarettes just because you guys were. I'm like,
bet you won't do it.
I wouldn't have finished it.
Yeah, my first time, I skipped school.
You're talking about skipping school.
And it was me, my buddy Tom, my boy Mike. And it was hilarious because Mike came up because we used to go up to this pool. It was like near the campus, high school campus.
Yeah.
And, you know, people go out there and smoke and shit, cigarettes or whatever. And I didn't really smoke. I was a jock, so I was just out there chilling. And, we're heading back to school, and Mike comes up like, hey, you know we got an assembly today. We're like, oh, word, fuck that. Let's go. So, boom, we take off to McDonald's. And once we got in the McDonald's line, it's like, you know, I was just playing right. And I was like, man, now we got a damn skip all day. We can't go back now.
Yeah.
So then Tom's like, hey, I know. Let's go to my house. Man, we smoked. And I remember, man, I laughed so fucking hard. Like, Tom was on the damn guitar with three strings, thought he was killing it.
Yeah.
Mike was next to him trying to freestyle, and this is a white dude.
Yeah.
It wasn't even freestyle, it was like a song.
Yeah.
My name is Mike, I went to the store, and Tom's like, doom, 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 doom. Like, yeah. They thought they were killing it, and I was beatboxing, I couldn't help it.
Yeah.
But I just
remember. They didn't have a bass around.
Yeah. So I just remember we were doing that for probably like 3 minutes, and we all kind of like stopped and looked at each other and laughed for about 2 hours.
Yeah.
And I went home.
Oh, shit.
And
ate all the food.
Oh my God, I was so fucking hungry. My mom said, "What's wrong with you, boy? What's wrong with you?" I said, "I fell asleep during my last class." I was like, "Damn, I already know how to lie about weed."
Yeah, I mean,
because she was like, "Damn, boy, what's wrong?"
You were fantasizing like, "That sounds like good. I'll do that tomorrow. That's a good idea."
But it was dope. Like, it took me 3 times before I got high.
Yeah, it was similar like that with me. What about you? First time smoking weed?
My aunt and her brother. His house.
Really? I never heard of this.
He was a barber. He cut hair. And he was like, coolest shit. He watched Naruto.
Did you want to smoke weed? That's what I was going to ask you. Like, when you smoked it, like, yeah, when you came, went that day, Mello, did you know, like, we're about to get high or you show up and they were doing it?
No, like, literally Tom was like, I got something. So we went back to his grade. We thought we were just going to go there and chill. He pulls out a joint.
And you were immediately with it. You're like, hell yeah.
I was with my boys. You
yeah,
know
yeah, I feel that.
I already skipped school. What the fuck else? I know, right? But that was the third time, though. I tried it.
Oh, okay. True.
First time I tried it, we were out in some woods near the park. Yeah. And my buddy was like, you see fucking ninja? I was like, I don't see shit. You know, like, and it didn't hit me.
Yeah, but see, kids hype shit up way too much, though. They're like, man, you about to fucking. I'm like, nah, it's just, I'm going to need this later in life, so don't fucking hype it up too much.
Yeah, man. What was it like smoking with your aunt? And
it was straight. It was just,
this is your mother's sister.
No, what the hell no.
So your dad's sister. She's just like some lady you're calling your aunt.
My uncle got married.
Oh, okay, my bad. So it's your mom's brother's
in-law.
My uncle's, my
sister-in-law.
Cool. Yeah, pretty much, yeah. But it was her and her brother, but he was like a barber. He cut hair and shit. And he like watched anime. So he like talk to you about anime while he cut your hair. So everybody would go to him because it's better than a regular conversation with a, you know, old black just talk about like, what you in school for? You play football, fuck you. You know, so like, it's not like no
sure
real conversation.
Football, yeah.
He'll talk to you about whatever you want to talk about. So everybody's like, I'll pay more money to go to this dude. And he was pretty good.
Yeah.
But like, I went over to get my hair cut around like 12 and nigga shit. I don't know. We stayed there until like 9 o'clock at night. And he was like, man, I'm about to smoke some weed. Like,
he's like, this little nigga sit here.
I'm a little kid. And he was like, I can't take it no more. I'm about to smoke some weed.
How old are you?
Like 15?
Yeah. You're about to be a freshman in high school, I guess?
Yeah, something like that. And then got super hungry. I was like, man, I ain't gonna do this again because it's drugs. My mom was like, I gotta go home with my mom. You know what I'm saying?
What was that like? Were you nervous?
Yeah, I was nervous, but I didn't even say nothing. I went, because I was so nervous. I was like, you know what? Go ahead. When you get in the house, you gotta talk to your mama out the gate so nothing seems weird. Yeah, so I go in there, I'm talking hella fast. I'm like, hey, mom, how you doing? What's going on? She's like, yeah, boy, what? She's tired. So she's like, yeah.
He come in like Kramer. Boom. Hey, mama, how you doing?
Like, yeah, hey, mama, how you doing? School's great. Got a haircut. Just all this shit.
Haircut.
Just wild.
You see the haircut? Got a haircut. Got a haircut.
But I'm weird anyway. So she's fucking right. She writes it off like he's fucking going through some hormones. Yeah. So, like, I've been weird my whole life.
Go check out your brothers. I'll go.
Yeah, whatever. Fuck your brothers. And then I'll talk to them. I'll go in the kitchen and eat a whole box of cereal. Some shit like that.
Did you tell them?
I ain't tell nobody, nigga. I went to sleep. I was like, eat food, go to sleep, never happened.
How long was it before you tried it again?
Oh man, I didn't smoke weed again. Nah, I smoked weed again until I was like 21.
Oh, shit.
Yeah, damn. I ain't doing this shit again. No, that's a lie. I did it one time. I came back from college. I was with my friends. It's such a fucked up thing. But okay, the backstory is this nigga said he was gonna fight my friend Jeremy. He's like, I'm gonna fuck you up when I see you. He's like, I'm gonna fuck you up when I see you.
Yeah, whatever
name,
reason.
His name was Odie. I ain't want to get into it. And fuck you when I see you. His name was Odie.
Was he upset? Like, was he scared? Like,
super
fuck.
Upset. Like, Jeremy called me. He was like, this thing gonna fuck me up. I was like, don't worry about it. We're going to college. We're not gonna see him again.
Okay. Nigga, he's still in the 12th grade. He ain't passed. You know he didn't pass.
Yeah, so it's pass. me and Risen, Jeremy. We all went to college. Mm-hmm. Our friend Myron didn't go to college. He was like, man, when y'all come back home, won't y'all come over and hang out, yada yada. So we go to Myron's house and he was like, Myron, where you at? He's like, man, come downstairs, man. I got a surprise for you, whatever. Somebody wanna meet you, something like that. We was like, all right, whatever. Risen goes, I think that's Odie car. Nobody listens. We get downstairs, the dude's like, I'm gonna fuck you up when I see you, is downstairs in the basement. But apparently it's all good now. It's whatever happened in his life, he's changed. It's like,
yeah.
We chilling. But this dude's like not like just by the cup, but he's like, I don't want to say a criminal, but he's not like, he was a wild dude, man. Like, like a lot of shit was going on in his life and like he was channeling it his way. You see what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Dude has some issues, whatever. But we just end up hanging out with this dude for like the whole day before we leave to go. I'm trying to get away from him. I'm trying to go home. I'm not driving no car. So I'm like, at some point we smoke a bunch of weed and we're like, all right, we're gonna drive to Odie's mama's house. And I'm like, all right, cool. Odie drove himself to Myron's house. I try to get in the car with Risen and Jeremy and Myron. These niggas like push me out and say, you gotta ride with Odie. Also something happened. Odie loved this girl named McGwen.
This is getting real right now.
I had lost some weight and I got a little bit of muscle going from like, I look different, you know what I'm saying? And
LeGuin,
LeGuin, no, I ain't fucked LeGuin. But LeGuin, she was just-
LeGuin won't fuck.
The queen was being hella friendly.
Yeah.
And like, I just started talking to her. When I came back, like, oh shit, girls talking to me. Look, we had bullied me for like a long ass time, so I was like, yo, this is my chance to like get revenge and type like everything. I can like lose my virginity. I get revenge. I can do a lot of shit.
Yeah.
So Le Guin starts talking to me. Mm-hmm. Odie was in love with Le Guin, like hard as fuck.
Her name's Le Guin. I mean, what?
Yeah.
What else do you want?
So we get in the car. I'm high as shit. We get in the car. Odie's like, I got a little bit of gas left. So we gotta drive fast so I get to my mom's house on time. Don't make no sense. I'm like, all right, nigga, whatever. I went past the seat. I'm high as fuck. He's driving like 95 miles per hour, and then like, he just starts talking about Le Guin like hella hard.
Oh shit!
You're like, I don't know
about how much he loves her, how much whatever, what he would do for her, how much he's done for her, how he would never let nobody get between them, and I'm just like. Yeah, I'm just my heart beating super fast.
I'm fucking nigga up when I say him. They get in between.
I'm like, bro, the whole time he's talking, I'm just like, yeah, don't look at him. Just don't make no eye contact. I feel like if I look at him, he's gonna hit me. So I'm like, just freaking the fuck out.
Deep, bro.
Straight. Odie had muscles. Odie had legitimate
Odie
like,
muscles.
He had legitimate grown man, like Abdou muscles. Like, fucking.
Yeah.
Abdou was 24. Odie had 24 year old muscles at like 19.
Yeah.
He's definitely 6 years ahead of me because I ain't have muscles. I was just fucking trying to like lose weight.
Yeah.
So yeah. I'm just fucking freaking out. We get to the house and then I'm like, I tell Risen, I'm like, I don't know this nigga, but we gotta get the fuck about it. Like, He's not well. Yeah. So we leave Myron and Odie at some point, but I'm like, we can't just keep hanging out with this dude, man. He's fucking dangerous.
Yeah.
And then we talked about that shit last night at the house. Like, man, that was not cool. Like, just to fucking blindside us.
Yeah.
I was ready to fight, though. I was ready to fight.
Yo, let's get
I was ready to fucking kill somebody.
In a car that was moving 90 miles per hour?
No, I was like, when we first walked down into the basement.
First saw him.
I was like, I'm going to hit this nigga with something. Yeah. Because, like, the last thing he said to my friend was, I'm going to fuck you up when I see you.
That's crazy.
So,
see, that's one thing about crazy motherfuckers. Like, there's this one dude. I ain't going to say his name. I don't think y'all know him. I don't know. I ain't gonna say his name.
Fair.
But this nigga crazy. Like, I'm talking like the crazy, like, cause he was trying to fight me over a contest. Said I cheated. I was like, how the hell did I cheat?
A comedy contest?
A comedy here.
Oh shit.
And so he was talking all this shit and I was like, I ain't fucking with him. He crazy. Like, you got killed crazy. Like, you just don't fight crazy.
Yeah.
And I've seen him hit people.
Yeah.
Oh. See, it's one thing. When you actually see what this motherfucker
can do,
and then I'm just like,
I didn't cheat, but I'm sorry, bro. I don't know what is going on right now. Because
look, one night we're at this spot, and some dude heckled him, and he just took the mic, typed him on the head, but it made that boom sound, and the dude just was like, slapped the shit out of him. I was like, obviously that dude drunk. He don't know who he just hit, so people had to break him up. So his boy was like, yo, let me smooth this shit out. So went to the dude. Got him up and they met up and he went to put his hand out to shake it and the dude went to go shake his hand, man. It was just like flop and I never like it was you know in cartoons when people fly in the air after they get hit like
what
I'm saying, that's how dude like it was
a 6-inch
and it
punch.
Was just wow and he knew. He crazy and he know karate.
Yeah.
How fair is that?
That's not
you
fair.
Need a machine.
Crazy
gun.
Niggas take karate. That's the people, one thing they will do. Like, I know. It's consistent. Like, I'm going to take martial arts.
I know. Karate niggas are crazy that? People.
I'm going to learn how to use a sword real good.
Fuck. Make my body into a weapon.
There was a crazy white kid in my high school. I can say this nigga's name. He was going through some things. But I assume he's live now. Mm-hmm. But the nigga was like a little fat white kid, nerdy as shit. Nigga was proficient with the long blade, like the long sword and shit.
God.
I was like, nigga, why? And he was like, people keep fucking with me.
No, I got it right.
I was like, I mean, it's cool you're not a mass shooter, but like, he's proficient with the long sword.
Yeah, out there chopping bamboo.
Yeah.
be outside his yard practicing.
Mm. Dude, I was just thinking about the first time I smoked weed is with this dude named Matt Ashley. And Matt Ashley, he was like, I was a good kid. Straight up. I was a good kid. And he was just straight up like a bad kid. And that was
bad kids fuck you up.
But
bro.
We were linked with skateboarding. We both skateboarded, so we would hang out, we would go to each other's houses, and we were just like honestly on some like young chubby dude shit. Like we hung out and shit.
You chubby, I'm chubby.
Let's do it. And
you do find fat friends. Like, yeah. We gotta work together.
We're like having sleepovers, and my mom's like, you can be his friend, but I know he's doing some fucked up shit, so if you're gonna do some fucked up shit, don't get caught. Like, that's like what my mom's telling me pretty much.
Yeah.
And like, we're at this age, I remember this so vividly. Like, I forget what show joked about it that was so funny, but he had an older sister, and this is like right when cell phones were really popping. So she's like being able to like take videos and stuff. And he's like, dude, I found this shit on my fucking sister's phone. And it's like her sending shit to her boyfriend of her like naked and shit. And he was like, it's kind of gross. I don't want to look at it because it's my sister, but I know I just found like a naked woman and this is valuable to us. So here, like, he was like, just look and I'll put it back or whatever. But in the text message, he's talking about weed. He was like, dude, she has a bag of weed in there. We can smoke weed. I'm like, as soon as I knew we could smoke weed, I was like, we might have to smoke weed. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
We do. We were at the skate park. But at the time, I didn't question it. Like, he wouldn't really look at it. He was like, I found it, and I don't really want to look at it because of my sister.
You found the sexy photos. You found the sexy photos that had the conversation of weed in it.
Yeah.
You're like, fuck it, let's just get the weed now, too.
Yeah.
He
was like, dude, she has so much weed. I'll just pinch off a little bit. She won't notice, and we're going to get real high because we never smoked weed before. And I was like, you're a bad kid, and I believe you. So let's do this shit. I don't know. I don't have a sibling that I can go get. I don't know. I have any connections. I don't have anything. So we took, you know, those big pencils that are like green or red or yellow, and they have like a little grip or whatever, and they're long. We crack one of those in half. You know how it holds like the white eraser?
Yeah.
You take the inner part of it, so it's like a tube with a little bigger part, kind of like a bowl where the plastic eraser or where the eraser was. What you do, you put like a little nug in there of just like some brown dirt weed, and you just light it really lightly and just hit it straight. And that's how we fucking smoked. And there's like a little hole that we like tried to use in our mind as a carb, and we just got high in the woods out back behind the skate park. And like I walked back and I was like, this is incredible. I kept trying to describe it to my friends. I was like, it's like everything that's happened already happened. It's like everything that's happening now.
Kids playing weed.
I was. This is my 2x explanation. I was like, smoking weed is like telling someone about what happened a week ago, but it's happening right now. Like, this is all a story in the future, but it's right now.
People explain that shit well. It's one little bag. Like, she wasn't bad, but she was like loose for an Indian girl. She was
what the
what?
All the other Indian girls are like super strict in my school, and like this other girl, she was like, "Fuck all that! I'm getting in white boys' trucks. Yeah, I'm fucking at the Waffle House."
What? That's very.
This is wild shit. Like we were like, yo, you fucking heard something about to happen because like she don't like her parents, bro. Like we knew that shit.
Yeah.
But she was like smoking weed. I was like, you bad as shit. How was weed like? She was like, it feels like you're dying, but it's good. And I was like, I don't want to do that.
I think I remember telling my friends. Because I was young enough at the time, because I was in sixth grade when we did this. I'm like a young, like, good kid. I remember telling my friends that I was like, you know when you have a sleepover and you're hanging out with your friend and it's late as fuck and their parents want to sleep, so you're trying to be quiet, but everyone's laughing, everyone's a good time. It's like that immediately in 5 minutes. Like, immediately it's the sleepover and we're all having the best night of our lives, but it's just the afternoon and our parents are going to pick us up in an hour. But
like, weed is not one of those drugs where you try the first time and you're in it. Like, I don't know anybody
Who loved it the first time?
No, who had a horrible experience.
I know a couple people.
That had a horrible
experience. Yeah, I do. I for sure do. I know a couple people. But it's like they're not accepting it. They're like, oh, it makes me
I was like, your life is not going to accept this. And like, it's just, that's just something that's going
to
happen.
Yeah, and I can understand people that like, I smoke weed and then I don't want to talk to anybody. I want to fucking just go home and I don't want to be social. It makes them not social. I can kind of understand that because sometimes I'll show up to an event where I feel like I'm the only one high, like work, and I'm like, I feel bad for what I've done, but I also feel great right now.
Well, I mean, I think
like I don't feel bad.
Did you smoke weed? And I'm like, I'm on top of the fucking world.
No. But you ever you ever have a conversation? You're like, that was kind of awkward. And you're like, but was it? Or am I like overthinking that situation?
Nah, because I'm pretty cool most of the time. Like, if something's awkward happening, I'm pinpointing it on this person.
Yeah, they were the problem.
Yeah, I'm like, they shouldn't have said that.
Yeah.
Yeah. Nothing. it was a whole nother story about mushrooms I did in D.C.
So with that, you can have bad experiences.
No, I felt like kind of like what he said. I was on top of the world. Yeah. This dude got slapped.
Physically slapped?
Yeah, but go ahead. What are you
I would say with any drug, man, it's about how you feel going into it. Like you're like. My name's Abdou. I drive an Audi. I handle my shit. I can take mushrooms. Muscles, like you would have a good.
You're like, I didn't go to college.
It just shows you your life, and you're like, okay, these are the bad parts. These are the good parts. Focus on the good parts. Get rid of the bad parts. I'm good. Like that's mostly what it is. If anybody's freaking out, something happened that they're not talking about.
Yeah.
And it just comes out with the mushrooms. Same with marijuana. Like,
besides,
people say they throw up. I'm like, who's throwing up? Like, I've never gotten nauseous. I've never gotten nauseous.
On edibles, you're just so fucking high and like feeling crazy.
Edibles, I'm like, I can't be at work right now. Like, that's one thing.
I would never do edibles and do anything. I just sit down and watch TV. I mean, granted, that's a lie too.
We are low-key running out of time, and again, batteries and batteries are foo-foo. But wrap-up questions. Do you have ideas for wrap-up questions for Abdu, for Mello?
How's it been, man? Just fucking like overall scale of 1 to 10.
Yeah, working a good night.
How's it been? 10, definitely. I haven't really had any issues with anything. I've been enjoying every day that I come in. So.
If for some reason we make it, I'm calling you. Yeah. Straight up. We'll be on the same fucking coast, too.
Let's get it.
Good.
We'll be on the same plane.
I got lots of ideas and marketing stuff.
Hey.
Hell yeah. We need ideas.
Yeah. We need niggas that already got Audis.
Hey, yo. I'm like, too. They said to go book and they want to talk to somebody. You drive up first.
Yeah. And play up the mysterious brown shit. Fucking have an accent.
If they ask where you're from, don't say nothing.
Some oil money might show up at the door. Some oil money. Yeah, might show up at the door.
Then we're going to pull up with Hondas and shit, like, right after.
A fucking passenger van. Yeah, Mello, what the fuck? How we just get right? Just tell us how to get
bro,
right.
Yeah, bro, what do we got to do, man?
Yeah,
straight
just
up.
Tell us.
How do I become a feature act? That's a legitimate question.
Yeah.
That's a legitimate question.
You just got to, man, y'all should be features. Y'all ain't featuring?
We feature some places.
Some places, yeah. But just in general, to any kind of, maybe not just us, but just in general, like, what is something, if you want to be a feature act, what should you do?
Have 30 minutes.
Hey, talk about it.
Talk about it.
Be funny.
Yeah.
No, man. I mean, the best thing I heard, it was right when I started being featured, Ralphie May said, you got to talk to people, man. You got to not be afraid to talk to headliners.
Yeah.
Or anybody. I mean, they're in your position, too.
Yeah.
They understand it. So just open your mouth, man. Just have a regular conversation. Granted, some of them don't like to talk, but at least try.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, yeah, because that day might not be good, but the next day might be.
And they'll remember that.
Yeah.
And people.
Talk to management, too. Don't be an asshole at the club you're working at.
Yeah.
And just open your mouth and, like, let people know that you can feature.
Yeah.
It's important.
Keep practicing. Keep writing.
Yeah.
As always.
Well, I stopped writing like 2 years ago, but other than
that. Yeah, that's just some next level guy shit.
That's some next level shit.
That's a couple podcasts from now, but.
Episode 200.
Yeah. This is episode 99. We're actually about to hit 100, so we're.
Oh, glad
to. You want to talk about the ghost episode 99?
Sorry, people know what happened. Yeah, so sorry we missed an episode, but we got some new equipment and I kind of fucked the audio. I guess it was me that fucked it up. I don't know how I fucked it up yet, but we'll figure it out eventually. But yeah, since this was like originally supposed to be your episode, do you want to pick the outro song that we go out on? You can pick any song. Something you've been listening to recently, just some shit you like to vibe in the car.
Any song.
A song you like listening to in the club, anything.
Acid Raindrops by People on Those Stairs.
Dude, I love that shit. Yeah, that is my shit. I fucking really fucked with that shit.
Acid Raindrops.
All right, well, thanks for listening, guys. Appreciate it.
Hey, thanks for listening to another episode of the Open Micers Podcast.
And listen, if you need to find us on Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, it is at the Open Micers. And for bookings or general questions, it's theopenmicers@gmail.com.
And if you guys are listening on iTunes, please, please, please go rate and review. Rate and review is the easiest way for the podcast to grow and to get more people to listen.
Yeah, and like, you know, just follow your dreams, nigga, you know?
Yeah, just in general, you got a dream.
Do that shit.
Do that shit, bro. Thanks.
Let's have a mid-city fiesta with your West LA connection. Hop inside the vehicle, start crossing intersections. We learning life's lessons while we blaze the cerebral lessons. A man but still a child and I have so many questions. Struggle all my life to evade the misconceptions. Then find a place to live between the negatives and positives. While trying to make money, slinging synonyms and homonyms. I went to Pop's house so I could visit moms and them. Cut to the mall, copped a brand new pair of Timberlands. Then dipped down a one-way, time to scoop up double K. And chill with my people on this bright and sunny day. My niggas spliff with sipping packs, I'm slapping hands with gas. Locate a shady spot so we can circulate the stress. Mary Jane invades my brain, now I can't complain. I'm saying, what else is there to do besides relax? Let the problems in your mind become ancient artifacts. Perhaps these raps can help you alleviate the things that's got you tripping. And watch me demonstrate. was straight. First you ignore the nonsense and clear your conscience. Let your pen touch the paper, write verbs and consonants. As the words become a sentence, you start to feel indifferent. The stress is out your mind, you feel like the weight was lifted. Terrific, I'm glad we had this time to discuss. I'm outro, call me if you wanna blaze one up. When the stress burns my brain just like acid raindrops, Mary Jane is the only thing that makes the pain stop.
I let the music take over my soul, body and mind.
To kick back, relax one time and you will find.
When the stress burns my brain just like acid raindrops, Mary Jane is the only thing that makes the pain stop.
Just let the music take over your soul, body and mind.
And kick back, relax one time and you will find.
I try to keep it stress free, take every day at a time. Make sure the family's in place and let the music unwind. I got plans to take charge like major outlets. I ride around the country chilling in my LA Express. On every street corner, the importance of having fun. Empty bottles, spilled tobacco, don't nobody carry guns. We keep our minds on fun and let the drums do the banging. On any given day like Mr. Cooper, yo, we hanging. Under the blue sky to stay laced and small. Pollute your quarter inch cables with all the sound that we brought. Can't get enough, so brother pass another cold one. Feel like a dad at a ball game, lamping with his son. Chuck D, y'all word up, we bugging overtime. From the light to the lime, original star time. It's the double Chris one, and Camel brought the ammo. So we can shoot game like us on your sport channel. Take off the do-rag, replace it with a thinking cap. If you didn't know, tell the bro he should've known that. We here for one thing, and that's to remain. What's the name? Nigga.
When the stress burns my brain just like acid raindrops, Mary Jane is the only thing that makes my pain stop.
I let the music take over my soul, body and mind.
To kick back, relax one time and you will find.
When the stress burns my brain just like acid raindrops, Mary Jane is the only thing that makes my pain stop.
Just let the music take over your soul, body and mind.
Kick back, relax one time and you will find. Yo, LA, hit me one time, make it funky. Double down on my underground sound. I'm feeling lucky for this jackpot, a jack spot to fill in my crates. We laid back, chilling and feeling the music relates. We on the to the two, hanging with my crew, bullshitting while we sitting down, drinking on some brew until the afternoon turns to the moonlight. Funky tracks, nickel sacks, freestyling all night, doing it right. No one with time, music make it better. My crew banging through blocks like shots from a Beretta. Snub nose to the hoes with problems, I suppose. Honey, you gotta understand your man's got flows, and I'm leaving you. So by the time I get to Phoenix, underground heads will fiend this musical genius, transferable by the books like Barnes with noble hooks, armed with overlooked talented guests. So God bless crooks to steal loops and keep this shit alive. Something for your troops to sit around and bye bye. From Camel, Double and Thess to ease stress, we brought the hip hop, so have fun and God bless.
When the stress burns my brain just like acid raindrops, Mary Jane is the only thing that makes the pain stop.
I let the music take over my soul, body and mind.
Kick back, relax one time and you will find.
When the stress burns my brain just like acid raindrops, Mary Jane is the only thing that makes the pain stop.
Just let the music take over your soul, body and mind.
And kick back, relax one time and you will find.
Pop collars to this, wear ice to this, drink Chris to this. Yo, is it something we miss? Pop collars to this, wear ice to this, drink Chris to this. Is it something we miss? Yeah, like my two-way, throw bows and do the shoulder shake. We throwing bows up in here, do the shoulder shake. Oh shit, my two-way, oops, my shoulder shake. Oops, I'm throwing bows. Overtime.
There was music and joy in marijuana. It was flown up fresh this morning from the border.